again to the Lake City National Comic Art Festival. It's a pleasure to be here with you and be hosting the big zombie comic draw, and it's all thanks to the Arts Council of England, so it's a real privilege to be able to do this again. We have a great lineup of people for you today, as always, so I figure I might just introduce everyone and we'll get stuck right into it. So over here we have a man who's not very well practiced at drawing zombies, but he's going to do his best today, and that is Charlie Adler. Over at Cincy we have Sean Phillips, who has had a little practice drawing zombies. And then over here, starting out on couch with me, we have Luke McGarry, and I'm going to butcher the name, but it's Pateri Tikkanen. And it's,
So to start off, I thought what I'd get the guys to do is essentially what they're known for. So we're going to go for classic zombies, but their style, what they're known for. We're going to have a bit of a chat here and then swap over. We're just going to keep doing that throughout the session and see what comes up.
Can we start then?
You can start. Yeah, start your pencils.
Thanks.
Now you might notice this year we don't have a split screen, so we're going to just keep alternating between the two. So you'll get a little bit of a glimpse of what Sean's doing, then what Charlie's doing, and vice versa, and we'll keep going that way. And occasionally we'll check back in with them. So I guess for you two guys, Pateri, we got to speak once before, but Luke, we haven't had a chance to chat. So I wanted to hear a little bit more about kind of both of your work and let these guys know what it is you do. So Luke, if you want to.
I do a load of magazine work and concert posters in the States. I do a thing called Sad Chewy online, or I used to. I haven't done it recently because I forgot. and there hasn't been too much Star Wars news lately. So
I guess the next
one we need to know
when you come back, it'd be that Chewy's extra sad because you forgot him.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah,
just kind of left in the corner.
Left in the corner. Yeah.
So yours is more illustration based, but stuff like Chewy would be, you know, strict cartoons, I guess.
Yeah, a bit. My stuff is kind of a mix. I have an Instagram that I do a drawing a day every day. I mean, my work appears elsewhere, but I've been doing the drawing a day on Instagram for almost 4 years now.
Right.
That's sort of led to a bunch of stuff, but I guess that By the virtue of that format, it's sort of a single panel, sometimes mini comic thing.
Yes.
It's basically a panel strip on Instagram.
And for you, Pateri, could you tell us a little bit about your work? Because has it been translated into English yet? Or?
Some of my work has been translated into English.
Mm-hmm.
Couple albums in French and one in German.
Run.
But still, the English word is English world is waiting for my work. I can say that I have a split vision. I do a growing up story of a little boy in a small village in Finland.
Mm-hmm.
It's called Eero, and his friend Kanerva. I've told their stories through albums, and they grow up during the albums, and well. That's ordinary Finnish life, added 50% of my life, and 50% made up, and usually the dullest moments are made up. So another thing is superhero wrestler called Black Pider, which I actually also perform.
Mm.
So I make performances and play guitar in front of audience. And what I see and what I feel, I put back on the paper.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like three-dimensional comic character, which I use as a starting point to experience things. I make comics. And actually this bag contains and t-shirts, which you can see in the candle here. There's a black pilot behind there, and then me. So, and actually the black pilot is not a very good musician, but he's really eager to please. So that's the flavor.
So when you're doing that stuff with this black pilot, is that sort of fodder or inspiration for your books then? Because you were saying that the dull stuff is made up, so the interesting things come from you.
I think so, that I've witnessed a lot of different things in concerts, what the people do on stage and how they behave back in the back room. When I'm on stage, I'm a totally different person than I'm here. So the conflict between the cozy and warm father figure and the biggest rock star ever on stage, like he thinks himself Blackfire. So the conflict creates interesting things. And when you put that rock hero again in the normal situation, family life, it becomes alive.
Mm. Well, that was why I wanted to get you two guys on the couch first to have a chat, because you kind of have that in common, that musical aspect of yourself. So do you want to tell us about your music, Luke? Is it, do you go into a character for it?
Yeah, I'd say much like Black Pider, I'm not a very talented musician, but I'm eager to please. I don't know. I never understand really, because you hear about like Beyonce has an alter ego that's who she becomes when she's on stage, and she's named it Sasha Fierce, and I don't really understand that. I feel like me on stage is just me, but I talk a bit more. Not stage banter, I'm terrible at that, but I'm sort of louder on stage.
Okay.
Yeah. I think it's still just me, I'm not sure.
So there's not a persona that you put on, or you don't have sort of a lucky outfit or something like this?
Not really. Maybe I should. Maybe I should start doing that. I think I just like showing off, regardless of whether I'm on stage or drawing. Yeah.
I was going to say, does that blend across then into your art? So sort of the person you present when you're, here as Luke McGarry artist, or Luke McGarry, pop star or whatever, as opposed to just you at home, there's like those two sides?
Maybe a bit. Because I do draw myself a lot in my work as well. And maybe it is actually probably a bit different. I think in my comics, when I draw myself, I'm dumber than I like to think I am. The comic version of me is not very smart. Maybe.
Okay. I mean, that aligns with something that Seth said this weekend. I don't know if anyone had the chance to see or meet Seth, but he's an incredible cartoonist. And he was saying that basically it's like, all my work is about me. He said it is an extension of ego. That's what it is. So would you say for both of you that is the case?
Maybe. Seth is the Canadian guy.
Yeah.
Right? Yeah. Well, I mean, he dresses like a cartoon character anyway.
Well,
you know it when you see
him.
So like, yeah, exactly. It's really cool. Maybe I should develop more of a look. He looks like Dick Tracy. I like him a lot. If you've seen Dick Tracy walking around, that's Seth, you've met him. I like him.
I think so. It's more of a play for me.
Right.
I play as I'm full-grown man, and I play as a superhero wrestler, and I'm allowed to play with my action figure on stage. So
that's literally, you are your action figure.
Yeah.
So what's the craziest thing that you've done on stage, and what's the one thing you still haven't been able to bring yourself to do?
Well, one dream is to perform in front of a Japanese audience. I've heard a lot that they enjoy when you totally give yourself to the audience, even though you might not be the best musician.
Yeah.
But still, something interesting happens usually. When I've had the most fun gigs in front of the audience, which is not a normal gig
right.
audience, like in the galleries or in schools, or actually actually lecture college environment provides possibilities to wrestle with the cardboard wall or break things and lift. Once I was in one book con, and there was old furniture in the corner. I didn't know that they were expensive, but I played with them and I lifted them. And no one said that, don't do that. But it, well, there's always danger with the black fighter. What happens?
Yeah.
Something might break, but sometimes not. And if I'm, I let the faith decide what breaks and what not.
And then at the end of it, you're like, hey, it wasn't me, it was Black Pride.
Of course.
Yes.
And I can always make a comic out of it.
Mm. Do you guys break things on stage at all?
I'm trying to think. I don't think we've broken anything. One time we played a show in LA, and there was this kid who he played in the opening band, and he kept jumping on stage when we were playing and wiggling around and that. But we weren't open to stage invaders at the moment. It wasn't that time of the show, and after about the fourth time he got on stage, I just went up behind him and booted him off the stage. I just stuck my foot in his back and kicked him into the audience. And we found out afterwards that he was a massive fan and he was the kid that got us booked on the show. But I think it was part of the experience for him. But yeah, it was just, who is this kid? Get him off the stage. So yeah, got rid of him. So I think I broke that kid.
Yeah. His version of the story is like, never meet the hero.
Yeah, exactly.
But you must know that there's always tension between the audience and the artist. Does it work? Does it go well? But if you break something, it breaks the ice anyhow. If you don't break the charts, you break the ice between the audience. You get 50% on your side, and 50 might hate you to the core, but it's still the experience you feel together.
I'm just looking around at what we've got on stage here and wondering if Julie's still in the room or not. Maybe we won't do anything today. Now, I can see that the guys are maybe getting sort of close to the end.
Finished?
Yeah?
Yes.
I think you could have a future in this. This is quite good. I like this. Yeah, and you should try some more of these. So I think it might be a good time, if Sean's happy as well, to swap over. Yeah?
Okay.
And so I was thinking for Luke and Petri to do Zombies as Rock Stars, given our discussion just now.
Okay.
So you can choose your weapons as such.
All right, I'll jump on the Cintiq if nobody minds.
So I guess, since they're going to be doing Zombies as Rock Stars, and we were having the musical discussion, we can kind of continue that now, because we have another rock star in our midst.
So famous, yeah.
Sean just has the look, but then Charlie's the... I'm saying you don't.
It's funny, isn't it? There seems to be a big tradition in comic artists as musicians. Well, I use that word with inverted commas from my point of view, since I play the drums. I'm in a band called Cosmic Rays. We were formed, I've been playing in bands since I was 16, but the latest band was formed for a Birmingham convention about 10 years ago, and we were a covers band at the time, and we were called Giant Size Band Thing, and we just enjoyed playing together and carried on, and various people left and various people joined, and we ended up being what I wanted the band to be, which is an original material band. So I'm sure hopefully a few of you have bought our latest EP, which I've been sort of trying to flog every time I sit down. But it's been a bit more of the soft sell, not the band. The soft sell, because normally I force you lot to buy our vinyl album by saying you get a free sketch every time you buy an album, or you get a free album every time you buy a sketch,
yeah.
One way or the other. But this time I was trying out another approach, was just have it there and see what people buy. So
was this so you didn't have to do sketches for them?
No, I still have to do sketches. So no, it's great. It's great, and we play. We do the odd gig here and there, but I really like doing original material, and we've been concentrating, on doing the second album. It sounds all very grand, the second album, but we are a hobby band at the end of the day. We're a bunch of middle-aged guys who sort of just want to do music beyond, sort of covers.
So what, you're working on the second album, but you've got an EP out?
Yeah, well, yes, which is two songs which will be on the album, but two sort of exclusive tracks as well, which, I mean, if anyone wants it, I've got some in the bag, so only £5. But I'll take a little doodle as well. Which was our old guitarist who left, Phil Winslay, comic book artist. Don't worry, it wasn't some great dramatic leaving where he was like threw his guitar in the air and just said, I'm out of here. It was all very amicable, but we were going to do a second album with Phil, and then he left, but we had two songs sort of left over, so it was nice to put it out in some form,
yeah,
without sort of putting on another album, because we wanted the second album to be with our new guitarist, and just to have sort of that identity, because we have changed slightly because of just new people.
Right. So you were saying that two new songs won't be on the...
Yes, folks, two new songs, exclusive to the EP.
There we go. It's like, I don't know, the one-shot special issue or something.
Exactly.
Only available in that format.
Precisely.
And it's vinyl, right?
No, the EP's just CD, because it's not... The new album will do an awful... So I quite fancy doing a picture disc next time, actually, on vinyl. That'd be quite cool. Yeah, I did try and make it a bit more sellable. Put some nice artwork there.
Yeah. Charlie went to Toronto last year at the TCAF with my son Jake, and me and Jake both buy a lot of vinyl.
Yeah.
We talk, Charlie managed to buy his first record for like 20 years, wasn't it? And he's got books now.
Yeah. I literally increased my vinyl collection at least doubled it since he took me to Toronto, because he got me back into it again. Yeah, we're all of the age we started off on vinyl, and I'm sure exactly like you said, we all stop buying vinyl, and then, that one trip to the record shop was the slippery slope.
Well, that was the natural segue I wanted to make, because you're quite the vinyl enthusiast, Sean. I mean, your Instagram is just a great sort of procession of fantastic albums, but also fantastic album covers.
Well, mostly that's why. I mean, the reason I got back into vinyl was like here about 3 years ago, 4 years ago maybe. I put on an exhibition in the Kendall Museum of comic record covers drawn by comic artists, like real ones. The most famous one being Bat Out of Hell by Rich Corbin. But when I was asked to do put the exhibition together, I found out there was a lot more than I thought there was. I was really worried that we wouldn't be able to fill the museum, but we did. There was hundreds of artists to choose from. So that I was starting to buy them. I had a budget to buy records. The exhibition was just 12-inch vinyl sleeves. That's how we managed to make it manageable, rather than CDs or singles. So I started buying the records for the exhibition. I thought, well, I'd listen to some of these. I then went and bought a record player, and it all sort of snowballed from there. So yeah. But now, the stuff I tend to buy, I'm attracted by the artwork. Usually, some of the music's good too. But when we went to Toronto, we found a record shop that's just sold secondhand vinyl. And I bought about 10 albums, maybe purely for the cover art. I had no idea. A lot of soundtracks. Yeah. So they tend to have whoever the film poster does the record.
So have you done any record covers?
I have actually. I did three this year.
Wow.
After a massive break, I did two in 1990.
Right.
When vinyl was still a thing, a regular thing.
Yeah.
I did Stereo MC's second album, the one that wasn't a hit. The next album was a big hit. But I did that. Not because of the cover, obviously. And I did a sort of folk rock band called Men They Couldn't Hang If They Weren't One of Their Albums.
Yeah.
And then that was it for 25 years. And then when I was putting the exhibition together for Kendall, Phil Hodges, who was releasing Men They Couldn't Hang, happened to tweet that he was looking for an artist to do the new record cover. I didn't do it, but my son Jake did it.
Right.
Because Phil thought that'd be quite cool that, you know, the next generation did.
Yeah.
And since then I've done a couple more. This year I did a Scottish record label at Touch Me. They're based in Glasgow. They're not for profit. All the money goes to the artist. The actual label doesn't make anything. Very small boutique label. And this guy just asked if I asked to do a record cover, and he couldn't pay me, but I could get free records. So I'm now a lifetime member of their label.
Mm-hmm.
And every time they got new releases, they do most of their stuff's on vinyl or on cassette or USB stick or whatever. So I get a few free albums every couple of months, which is great. And I do a soundtrack as well for Arrow. We usually do DVDs. They do like black exploitation films or old horror movies and stuff like that. So I did a soundtrack, vinyl soundtrack album cover for Italian horror movies from the 60s. You trust me. Which is great, because that's so big, it's just so nice to draw something that isn't comic sized.
Yeah. I feel like I'm getting hints that the
other page, don't they?
No, it's still colouring.
No, there we go. One thing I want to ask, and we will swap over again in a moment, but the obvious and obligatory question when you're doing this kind of thing is, what do you think is, you know, explains or accounts for the injury?
See that exactly.
That's your question.
Should we wait till he's gone? I suppose with zombies, because it's more of a force rather than a character, you know, all the classic sort of monsters and the monster tropes and everything, you know, whether you talk about Dracula or, you know, werewolves or whatever, they're all single, more character-driven monsters. The zombies, I think, just, you know, represented by things like the coming apocalypse, the collapse of society and everything, so it's a bit more, it can be, I think, sometimes more, I suppose, significant to society at times, especially, you know, in the last 20 years. So, you know, I don't know, it's one of those things you theorise on stuff.
Yeah.
Trying to be serious here. Bloody comedians. I'll shut up now.
All right. I think there we go. I have a feeling we've reached the end of the zombies as rock stars. And so what I want to do is swap over again. And for this session, I'm going to have Luke stay up there, but Charlie's going to go and join him. And for this one, it's zombies in everyday life, which I feel is very much everyday life for Charlie. So I thought what might be interesting to have a chat about now with Petri is, Can you tell us a little bit about the comic scene in Finland? You know, what is it like? Because obviously you've seen a glimpse of it here this weekend. We've all been able to engage in this way and be sort of are familiar with the work that's done here. But what's it like in Finland? How rich is the scene?
I have to say one thing, that in Finland we don't have magazines for kids or young adults that you could send your comics and they would publish and you could get something, a bit of payment.
Mm-hmm.
So we have a basically a really strong alternative comic scene because of that. Because people don't get the traditional magazines you can put your, or you should do in a certain way those comics for certain magazines. So everyone who's on the scene, who starts, usually start from fanzines. And they develop their style, and some of them might get professional and get like publishing house behind them and continue like me. So I started from the fanzine scene. So still there is a really rich variety of artists, strong visual language, which is not so based on any build up like superhero genre or just funny animal stuff. There are a lot of experimental comics, artistically you could say that some of them look more of like a painting comic, somehow in a classic way, that there is a lot more variety and experiment in Finnish comics.
Right. So are you able to just work full time doing comics now?
Well, we get grants and I'm quite lucky, so I've been working for half a year or 1 year with one album or two albums.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm in a good position.
Mm-hmm.
But there are a lot of young artists who would like to have grants. It's not so possible, but still they want to produce, and the blogs and the internet has given them the opportunity to express them without actually putting a lot of money in it.
Mm.
So it's still possible to get popular in Finland without even publishing house behind you. But usually when you are popular in internet, publishing house gets interested and they might publish your work. Like, well, one success here in Finland is actually J.P. Ahonen Beelzebubs. It's a comic about it's ordinary family life, but they are black metal family.
Right. Okay.
So they worship different things and they get conflict. It's funny because it's almost like a ordinary family life mixed up with the aesthetics of a metal world.
So it's like the Osbournes.
Yeah, you could say that. Yeah.
Okay. And this is a comic series that someone
has it. It's in the internet and also now a book. And actually the online comic, it's in Facebook. It has like 100,000 followers.
Wow.
Or something. So some of us are lucky. And usually it's related to those artists are able to produce their stuff already for the foreign markets. So the language barrier. If you can write English, the artist is not only Finnish, but it's the global.
Right. So there is that consideration of trying to do it in English so as to broaden and get the global audience.
People tend to write and draw their own stuff, or they expect to do people.
There are some groups who work together, and there are some writers who only write and for a variety of magazines for different artists. But I'm not talking about comic magazines, but different kind of lifestyle magazines. Or, well, there are couples who work together.
Mm. And what's your kind of workspace like? You know, where you actually do your art? You know, do you have a studio? Do you work from home?
Yeah,
what's the setup?
I have one room full of stuff, and I have a small space on the table where I work.
Mm-hmm.
And things keep falling on me, and I try to survive. And it's almost like I'm fighting against my need to gather things around me. And I think so. It's something.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah.
Yeah. Is this something you could?
Yeah, I've got a room in my house and there's full of books and a scaffold full of vinyl as well.
Right.
space I have to draw to get smaller and smaller, which is unfortunate because Wacom just about to bring out a really big Cintiq. I really quite like one, but I'm going to get a bigger desk. So everybody decide what to do about all the other stuff that's encroaching.
Yeah. What and do you have all that stuff in there because you just want to surround yourself with it, or is it banished to that room?
It's banished to that room. Yeah.
Right.
I have in the living room. There's a bookcase full of books, but they tend to be not comics.
That's all the comics that you're allowed to have out.
Yeah. Nice illustration books or graphic design books or fine art. A few comic ones, but only if they've got a really nice spine.
Right. Do you have a studio at home or?
Okay. I never have. I used to have one outside the house. But
yeah.
When I first started.
Nah. What?
Because the stuff I want is always not going to be at home. I like it. I like it at home.
Yeah?
That's where the cats are. I can talk to the cats.
So you're surrounded by cats and records.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Living the dream, man.
And what about your kind of routine? Like, what do you have a routine as far as a way to make yourself work? Do you
hours? Yeah, this is a job, you know. I find the incentive of actually, if I don't get a drawing, I don't get any money. I find that really helps. So, I'm in my studio by, I don't know, 8:30, 9 o'clock, and I work till 7.
Right, usually.
Well, I say work till 7. I'm in my studio till 7 on the internet, or book my book.
Yes.
Wait for inspiration to strike. Yeah.
Awesome.
Procrastination.
Yeah, posting pictures of your records in
play. Well, I do a daily walk. When my youngest son's getting ready for school, instead of staying at home and antagonizing him, I go out for a walk down to the sea and I take a photo at the same spot every day. And that gives me time to think about what I'm going to do that day.
Mm.
So, work stuff and any other stuff I might be thinking about. But yeah, that sort of clears my head, gets me ready to get back and do some work.
I was going to say, like, I've heard about people using that at work from home where they will go for a walk. And at the time they return, it's almost that's their commute. So when they arrive, it's like, okay, now I'm at work.
Yeah.
And
I remember talking to a friend years ago. Before I lived here, I used to live in Wales. I had a few acres of land and a massive barn. And I was playing to a friend that came to visit. I didn't need very much anymore for the commute. So what you should do is get like an old Rolls Royce in the barn, like up on bricks, and just like lay in the back seat for an hour, read a book, and then go to work.
Yeah.
That sounds like a good idea. But now I have a lot of space in it.
You need to try this though.
No, I've never had
one. I was kind of hoping that, well, you know, you end up with some sort of lesser vehicle.
But yeah, I didn't need to because I had this massive amount of land and we had like 100 trees, so I could go for a walk around the garden to take an hour.
So what about your routine, Petri? Like, you know, because obviously you've got to keep working to earn this grant money, so you know, how do you structure your day? Is there a routine?
Well, I usually, if I get a grant, for certain months.
Yes.
First, I have to try to cope with the works I've already promised to do before I can start with my comic. So now I end up in a situation that I got 6 month grant and I'm still working and the album should be ready until late December.
Right.
So I have 2.5 months to produce a 64 page album. But I think so I can manage that because when I'm done with the other illustrations I've promised to do, they are over. So I just jump in because I've been producing the story in my head already.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like printing it on the paper. I have certain parts, but I'm not so disciplined.
Yeah.
I can't work from 8 till 4 or 8 till... I just work when I can.
Mm-hmm.
I have a family I'm an active Pokemon Go player, so I have to find time to play Pokemon Go and then draw. So, but I'm going to draw Baba playing Pokemon Go, a comic.
You're right. Okay.
Yeah, so I'm working.
Wow.
About my studio, it's full of stuff that I stole. Told that it keeps falling, and I try to sell stuff in the flea market, and. I think so. The last things I'll sell are my treasured easy library. books, which are actually full of zombies and horror
films
from the 50s, which were not allowed and they were burned. So the horror comics is actually my own thing. I loved them when I was young. The Tales from the Crypt, the Pound of Fear, and the Vault of Horror. Those three comics are my, and actually the black and white collections, they are my treasure. So I'm really pleased to be drawing zombies in Brown in Kendall.
Yeah, well, where else would you do it, you know, really? I kind of feel like we're just about at the end of our drains, trains, and automobiles. So I think we might get ready to swap over now. Does that sound good with you, Charlie?
Yeah, I'm done.
You're done?
Yeah.
Excellent. Yes. So, Sean and Petri, if you want to pop up again, and this time...
Which one?
I was thinking, because you do all your walks all the time and Petri's come all the way from Finland, I thought travelling zombies might be a good idea. I feel like Luke kind of almost went down that track, so to speak. There's still room to play with that.
So, that's what sort of was just thinking, right, train, drains.
Grains,
farmer zombie.
Yeah, was that next? Did you have your next one lined up ready in your head?
I kept rhyming zombie things.
Like a French zombie dance.
Yeah. With a baker's hat on or something. Grains, yeah.
Exactly.
But that is a good example of what I wanted to ask you about, because obviously we're doing a lot of illustration and you know, trying to capture the right sort of message or the right thing in a single image, it's quite a skill set. You know, there's that skill of being able to tell a sequential story, but then actually just nailing one image that tells everything and really tells the whole story is quite an art. And it's something you do as well, Charlie, when you're doing a cover as opposed to the interiors. You know, it's like trying to absolutely nail it. For both of you, like, how do you slip into that mindset? Is it like flipping a switch between those two modes? Like, say, when you're telling a sad, chewy story, which, you know, has to run over a few panels, or you're just like, okay, I've got to nail this in an image. How do you go about that?
I think the only thing I ever have to remind myself is that you read it from left to right. So that's really, don't put the joke on the left. So that's the only mindset I really try to slip into is,
right,
you know, whatever is happening, just have it go from left to right. Yeah. I don't even have anything more in depth than that.
Well, mine's slightly different. I mean, when you're talking about covers, I always tend to prefer. I suppose prefer not to do a story type cover as opposed to, I always prefer the strong design image.
Mm.
You know, I almost would prefer to jettison any sort of nod to what's going on within the comic in favor of something that just makes the image pop. You know, it's always nicer to put a nice, strong, simple image, and especially as it, forgive the pun, loads of dead space somewhere, you know, because I just think, you know, single colours, things like that, just as a design aesthetic, just make things work, you know, and one of my biggest bugbears is, you know, when you go into a newsagent or a, you know, a supermarket, or you see a sea of magazines or whatever, and it's just a massive imagery that nothing stands out, because everyone seems to have the same idea of what a magazine or whatever looks like, you know, or certain types of magazines, like all the, you know, like Heat and all those sort of magazines, you know, Now and everything, it's just this intense sort of bombardment of words and imagery, and you see them all together, you just think, well, that doesn't attract me to anything, you know, because it's just this sea of stuff, just attacking you, and you know, and you want to to try and do that the same. And it's the same within, you know, the comics industry. You know, you've got a sea of whatever comics, and the majority of them are just sort of these big splashy images of your favourite character on the front just doing something fairly random. And you think, no, you need to be a bit more imaginative than that to sort of come up with an image that your magazine, comic, whatever, sort of sticks out from the rest, because then your vision, your eye gets directed straight to that one. So if you literally put, I mean, this is a very simple thing, if you literally put one solid colour on the front of the cover,
yeah,
that stands out, because everything else is just this sea of just detail and
yeah,
everything.
I'm inclined to agree. I find that, you know, like, yeah, you want to make it as striking as possible,
mm-hmm.
and when I'm doing concept posters and that, I almost resent having to put, you know, the date or the time or the ticket info or even the band name.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm just like, let me just do a cool image that stands up.
Yeah,
like, poster in the club. You'd have no idea what it was for, who was playing, or when or where, but you go,
I'll go to that.
Yeah.
And go
and
copy where it was.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Or you ask to do the whole thing, so you do all the logo design, all the typesetting and everything,
yeah.
Because
I do
then,
I insist
yeah,
on that
yeah,
with my
yeah,
stuff is
exactly.
And that's I hand letter everything as well, because it's like even, you know, typefaces can kind of achieve what I'm trying to. It's sort of, you know, yeah, let me do everything and make it one complete piece.
Yeah.
But then they go, oh, this band's dropped out, or you need to change this way. It's like, but that's part of the original artwork. Yeah.
But yeah, it can be ruined quite easily by, I mean, I did, going back to shorts to talk about album covers and everything,
mm-hmm.
I did an album cover by this Canadian rock band quite a few years back called Raven's Code, and apparently they're quite big in Canada, I don't think anywhere else, but yeah, I did this cover for them, but they were quite, I said, shall I do a logo as well, and they said, no, sorry, we'll put our own logo on, and I sort of left it, and when they put their own logo on, it was so different to the artwork I'd drawn, yeah, and in terms of style and everything,
mm.
It just clashed horribly with the artwork. And you just thought, what designer on the planet would think that looks good? And B, you know, I could have done it in a similar style to their logo,
mm.
But they insist on putting their with all the sort of,
yeah,
all the attachments to it and everything, and it just looked, it spoiled the whole thing.
Did they put it out like that?
Oh, they put it out like that.
yeah,
with their logo on it. And, you know, their logo was fine, but it would have required a different cover. It was as simple as that, not my cover. I'm the same. I'm kind of insistent if there is something like that.
There was a lot of time when you're doing concert posters, it's sort of, you know, you've got the headliner and the venue and the date, but, you know, the support acts are to be announced, you know, at a later date. So they go, oh, we'll just do the poster and then, you know, we'll fill in the text afterwards. And for ages, there was this band in LA that would always get added as support to these shows. And you leave a bit of space at the bottom for, you know, whoever is playing. And they were called The Underground Railroad to Candyland. And I was like, I will never fit that on the poster. So I resent that band to this day. I think they broke up. I'm glad.
Yeah, yeah.
Because, I hated trying to squeeze them in.
I thought you were going to say that, you know, finally you were doing one, you're like, right, I'm just going to write them on there.
Yeah.
And it was the one show they weren't going to
play. Yeah.
It's funny, you made it fit and like, oh.
Yeah.
Damn it.
So are you going to get, have you had the experience yet, I guess, where someone's come up with that album and they're like, can you sign my album for me?
What, this Raven's Code?
Yeah.
No, thankfully. I think it stayed in Canada.
Right.
I mean, I've done a few others over the time, but... one other band, a Belgian band called The Dukes, probably actually the only album cover I've done where I quite like the music as well.
Right.
They said we want to use our logo, but they gave me the logo first. So at least I could do the artwork to the style of their logo, and it fitted really nicely. But no one's ever come up with one of the albums closest I've ever come to sort of signing something where I've been associated with the band was Slipknot.
Right.
I don't like Slipknot's music at all, but and it wasn't an album, it was like a collaboration on an issue of Metal Hammer magazine where the lead singer was editor for the month, and
you do know they're setting in the back, right?
Yeah, we're core record. The members of Records Co. Yeah.
So, but yeah, I've signed a couple of those magazines that I designed the cover for and everything. But yeah, that's the only time.
So, do you get brought any of your albums, Luke, when you're signing or even here? You know, people can setting up with your music for you.
Yeah, I've had none of my albums. No, nobody buys mine. But I've had people come up with posters and stuff that I've designed for bands. The big one for me that I always get a kick out of is when members of the band come up and, you know, at a pub or something in LA and go, you know, oh, I saw the drawing you did of me and, you know, I hated it. I'm really offended by it, yeah. That's happened a few times.
Right.
One time I drew this band called The Trash Women and for a magazine, and one of them tracked me down. It's a good job we have a sense of humor, and that was my first review.
Okay, so you have like, yeah, not so much the concern about losing work that the Charlie does, but it's more like you've got these people who get a bit violent or a bit angry.
Yeah, they do. Another time I was backstage at a comedy festival, and this comedian Norm Macdonald, who was on Saturday Night Live Raiders, yeah. He's not aged particularly well, but yeah, he came up to me backstage and he goes, are you that idiot that drew me for the poster? I was like, hey, yeah, he's like, your work sucks. I was like, oh, man. And then he came back about 45 minutes later, I ran into him again and he goes, I just saw the way you drew everybody else and I guess it's pretty good, so. I guess he just didn't like his own version, but yeah, everybody else.
Right.
So that was nice.
Do you find the best people do come around like that?
Most people do, yeah. I feel like I've gotten a bit kinder in my caricature over the years just because that's happened so often. But yeah, for the most part, it's usually along the lines of we hated it at first and then really grew to like it. So yeah, that's nice.
best form of flattery.
Exactly, yeah.
If they come around eventually, that's kind of nice.
Yeah.
Yeah. And have you actually done any albums for other people then?
I'm trying to think. I have, but a lot of them, I got paid, which is the important part, and then I'm not sure whether the band broke up or what have you before it came out. So I've done about 5 or 6, but I'm not sure whether any of them actually came out or whether they were so indie that, you know, they released about 4 copies. But, you know, yeah, I'm trying to think off the top of my head. I can't think of any, you know, certainly anything that anybody would have heard of.
Don't know. Well, apart from the Slipknot thing, which wasn't an album cover anyway, I kind of prefer working for smaller bands because you haven't got to go. Because the thing with the Slipknot thing, even though it was just for a one-issue, Metal Hammer magazine, the amount of involvement, you know, from the management and the suits and everything that were involved, because they're a big deal.
Yeah.
And the amount of, sort of preliminary drawings, the amount of intervention I had, you know, and I was compromised on the artwork, etc., etc. It wasn't the most pleasant experience. Don't get me wrong, the band were great. The only people that were really good about it were the band.
Yeah.
And the editor of the magazine, the creatives basically. But when you get to that level, you know, they're completely, you know, they're not the ultimate deciders of what they should themselves look like.
Yeah, that's true, because I've done, I've done posters and, you know, stuff for bigger artists, but no album covers. But I do this thing, Coachella Festival in the States, where it's a calendar of all the sideshows in LA that all of the festival acts are playing. And we always have trouble with it every year because I draw each one of the artists and the artists never complain, but their agents and their managers and they're, well, you know, he needs more hair, he needs, you know, you need to make his eyes further apart. And the bands are usually quite happy with it, but yeah, it's the agents that weigh in and, you know, really drag things down.
Now, I think we started just a little bit late today, so we can just go a tiny bit over, and we've got time for one more drawing, which I'd love to get Luke and if Petri's happy to stay there,
What I wanted to do, because we were discussing this yesterday, Petri and I, just in terms of having, you know, zombies as a way of representing your country. And I guess you've got the unique perspective of being British American, but I think, you know, the American side might lend for sort of a richer content there. And I think the Finnish side, we did discuss, there's some fun options there. So I think representing zombies from your country would be good.
Why is the full color?
I'm not
impressed.
What's that movie, 27 Hours, except it's a leg, not a arm? So if you want to come back and join us.
I don't know, is there a comic yet, but this is Hobo Zombie. Traveling underneath the train.
Hobo Zombie. Come on.
Zombies in train. So we were talking before about your colours and that sort of thing, and one of the things that I want to get to with that that's quite interesting is obviously for the interiors on Walking Dead, essentially you're working in black and white, but when you're doing the covers, you need to think of the colour aspect. Is that something that because it's so different, you kind of relish that each month when you get to that, or actually is it a bit more like, okay, yeah, I've got to do that again?
Oh no, it's slightly different. As I described before, it's a slightly different discipline. It's, yeah, whereas interiors, you're more concentrating on storytelling. Storytelling is the god, you know. As long as your storytelling is correct, you know, everything else hopefully will click into place and you're fine. Whereas, you know, covers, and we're both of the same opinion, we both like stuff that, you know, pops, and we come at it from a more design kind of aspect. I mean, don't get me wrong, some of you could probably quite easily show me a comic which is completely, one of my comics, especially Walking Dead, which is completely not come from a design school, but that's
Robert's fault.
That's Robert's fault, yeah. Half the time, because he's the only guy that knows what's going to come up in 3 months' time, I'm having to take a lot of stuff from what Robert suggests, so sometimes you just have to go with an image, because you haven't got an idea for a better one. It's as simple as that. But because you don't know the story or whatever. But no, I don't do, because obviously I'm only doing my covers black and white, and then it's coloured by Dave Stewart.
Yes.
I never think in terms of colour for the cover. I always think in terms of what pleases me. And Dave's a good enough brilliant colourist, and he'll make it better as well.
Yeah.
I will finish a cover to a level where I think, yeah, I'm pleased with that, regardless of whether it's got colour on it or not.
Mm. Well, and you're working with your son now, colouring some of the work, Sean. So, you want to tell us a bit about that? Because that's got to be, I mean, that's just a different kind of scenario, it must be.
Yeah,
quite different.
I mean, the new book that I just launched this weekend, My Heroes Will Always Be Junkies, it was meant to be my part-time job while I was doing the last year of Can I Be Killed, but Ed took too long to write it. By the time we'd already scheduled it, it had to come out for this weekend, but it's the whole point of launches here.
Right.
So, I didn't start it until 6 months after, probably 9 months after I was meant to start it. And originally I was going to colour it myself, but it was never going to be Betty. It was always going to be me, because I had a very specific idea of what I wanted to look like, and it didn't seem right to tell Betty what to do. I never do tell her what to do, she's a brilliant colourist.
Mm.
So it felt it wasn't my place to sort of say, stop doing it how you do it normally, do it like
yes.
That idea that I've got. I can tell Jake to do that. And originally I was going to colour myself, but we ran out of time. I was still drawing it as the colours were coming in, so I just did the first page. Rather than a swatch of different colours, so these are the colours we're using. It's all about a Photoshop, so I suggested maybe Photoshop colours. It's worked out brilliantly, because it turns out he's really good at it. He's never covered anybody else's work before.
Yeah.
And I'm always disappointed in my colours, apart from Betty. She's never disappointed. I think they've Stuart when I had him cover for Tom. Some of that was, I was thinking, doesn't look like me, Nova. Towards the end, working with Betty, she was also covering Batman in Big Weeks, and she couldn't make my stuff look like Big Weeks.
Yeah, I was going to say that it may not be them, but yeah.
Yeah, so it's worked out really well. So I just told him what to do. We got that job. But now he's colored in the new, we launched Criminal again in January, and Jake colored in that as well. But for that, I've just left him to it. He's learned from the one job he's already done, and he's an illustrator anyway, so he knows what he's doing. So I just let him do it now. If we didn't like it, we'll tell him what we don't like. Mm. Ed's had some notes. And when he's finished the first issue, we'll probably go through it and maybe tweak it a little bit. Not much.
Right. And I guess one last quick question for both of you, because we are running short on time, I am aware. So just in terms of for both of you, you have been working with Robert for so long now, you've been working with Ed for so long. How do you guys keep it fresh? You know, in terms of that dynamic.
Well, for me, it does, because every year or two we start new projects.
But still with him.
Yeah, I know, but and always pretty similar, I must admit. Apart from the new one. The new one's made a romance comic, which is I wanted to draw a romance book because I used to draw girls' comics like Bunty and stuff when I started out, and wanted to have him go back to that sort of thing, but Ed can't really write romance. It's crime and drugs and death and stuff. I think for me it's just a new project every time. I mean, for you, it must be mind-numbingly boring.
Yeah.
But then you always get new characters.
Yeah.
People die off. You know,
yeah.
It's not like if you join, say, Superman every month, where nothing really changes over decades. Yours does.
I've been extremely bored for the last 10 years, I think. I've always said it's as long as the scripts continue to inspire, there's no reason I'm going to stop drawing it. It's like drawing a soap opera. You know, how many people, that's a weird analogy, but how many people start watching Coronation Street, for instance, and they're still watching it 20 years down the line? You know, you could argue, well, don't you get bored with the same characters, etc., etc.? Well, it's not. It's developing plot lines, it's familiarity with characters. So long as you keep it fresh, so long as you keep, characters interesting, so long as you come up with interesting scenarios and surprise me. And Robert, very good at surprising me.
As far as it goes, actually, when you're drawing a comic, you're so involved with that particular drawing you're working on and the problems there are in making that work.
Yes.
You don't really think about that bigger picture while you're working on it.
Yeah, that's very true.
And every script I get, I always think, like, God, how the hell am I going to draw that? But then you start and it works out fine. So it's usually more about the technical aspects of actually translating that script into a comic rather than what the story is.
I've said this to you before, I think you're in I'm jealous of your
talent.
Shut up. It always comes down to hair at the end of the day.
Sorry.
But you know, you have got the best of both worlds. You have a set number of issues, you know it does, even if it's starting to fade, you know, at the end, the interest in a book, you know it's only going to be X number of issues left, so it's almost you can keep going for and then you're onto something new each time, but it's a great guarantee, you know, and Ed,
because you're also always six issue trades, so you know that you're coming up to that chunk, so there's a big you tend to break these, what seems like an impossible task, down into very small pieces, like a panel at a time or a face at a time.
Speaking of a panel at a time, unfortunately,
panel
is at its time, and I believe there are other panels that need to have theirs. I keep getting the signals, you know, and not the good kind. So I think it's that time. But I like what you said before, Charlie, where you're talking about being with working with Robert and how, you know, you want to keep it surprising. And I think that was what we managed to do today, was to keep things surprising, to keep them interesting, to see zombies in different scenarios, and you know, to I guess give a little bit of life to them as such. As you can see, there is a finish
zombie coming out of a sauna, and I guess that is the perfect way to end with a Finnish zombie. So thank you everybody for coming along, and thank you to all our talented artists.
Good.